of citizens say that consumer brands play an important role in defining a country's culture. So there's a strong relationship between the brands and the nation. We also see that 78.6% of citizens say that the country a product is made in impacts their preference for a brand. So you could see that interplay between brand and country and how important it is today. And we started measuring the power of what does it mean to be made in a specific country? What does made in America mean, or made in China? And we can rank the power of these nations in terms of their exports. So, for instance, Germany ranks number one in terms of the country you'd want to buy an automobile from. They also dominate on pharmaceuticals and beer. So you could see a little bit of a balanced power of that nation. Italy is number one on fashion. So that's the top brand for when you're thinking about buying fashion brands. France owns cosmetics. In terms of the best countries for real estate, Canada ranks number one, followed by the United States and then France. So overall, again, you can see how the building blocks of a nation affect its overall ranking. And we're excited to share some more details with you. Back to you, David.
Well, now it's time to get an overview of the key insights from the 2021 study on a global perspective. And who better to do that for us than Professor David Ribstein from Wharton University? Professor Ribstein has been our partner in this study since it started, and his unique understanding and unique perspective of countries, of brands, and what's driving GDP growth is unrivaled. So let's hear from David now.
Hello, I'm Dave Riebstein. I'm a marketing professor at the Wharton School at the University of Pennsylvania. I've been involved with the Best Country Study since its inception. This year has been a different year. It's been a transformational year. There's been many things that have affected how we view countries and how we live our particular lives. First and foremost, obviously, we've had to deal with the COVID-19 and the tragic loss of millions of lives all around the world. Accompanying this has been the huge impact on economies of various different countries, leading to an overall global recession. Some countries have handled the pandemic well, such as South Korea and Taiwan and several others, whereas other countries have not handled it nearly as well. Accompanying this pandemic has been the subsequent vaccine distribution. And this has required acquisition of vaccines as well as some form of equitable distribution of those. Perhaps Israel has been the country that has done the best at it. There are others that are catching up, but there are other countries that are still struggling today with trying to manage the vaccine distribution. A third major thing that's been happening this year has been the Black Lives movement that originated in the United States and has found it in various other countries all around the world. Climate impact has been a major event that's happened in various different countries. Perhaps most notable are the brush fires that happened in Australia. We've seen other events, such as the explosions that happened in the Beirut port, killing millions of lives. And of course, we could not ignore Brexit and the impact that's had on the British economy, as well as the economies of Europe. Many, many events have made this year an exceptional year, and it's part of what it is that we've all had to adjust to. Perhaps the greatest impact, of course, has been the pandemic. And what we have witnessed as individuals is we see that how we buy and where we shop, that's changed. How we work, many of us working from home, some of us not having jobs. So there's been a dramatic impact for individuals, where we eat and how we interact with family and friends, dramatically affected, and we've had to adapt. Businesses have had to adapt as well. And what they have had to do is how they connect with their customers has changed. Meetings have changed. The ability to have trade shows dramatically affected. Their whole supply chain has been disrupted. And certain industries, such as the hospitality industries or the airline industry, have been dramatically affected, with sporting events being canceled throughout the world. So many, many industries have suffered as a result. And when I've talked to business leaders, almost inevitably, what it is that they tell me is they've needed to be agile. And it sort of is the buzzword that I hear from companies. But that's not restricted to just individuals and companies. Countries have had to adapt as well. And what it is that we have seen is we see, obviously, trying to get the healthcare systems up to speed and handling with this medical crisis that we've got, and getting medical supplies to the hospitals and to individuals has also been an issue. But trying to cope with the unemployment levels and trying to deal with that and supporting the local governments has been a major issue for countries all around the world. And what countries have had to do they've had to adapt as well. Well, we too at the Best Country Study have had to go through our own adaptations. We've added 13 new attributes that we use for evaluating countries, and we have taken one of the previous dimensions, that of citizenship, and we have morphed it into a dimension that we call social purpose. And what is social purpose? It has many of the dimensions that we had in citizenship, but it also includes dimensions such as human rights and racial equality and social justice and climate concern that have all been attributes that now feed into the social purpose dimension. And we've added a new dimension. And this new dimension, this new overall factor is one of course, agility. And what is it that we have feeding into agility? Our perceptions of countries in terms of their adaptability and in terms of responsiveness and how progressive they are and how modern they happen to be and how dynamic they are all feed into this agility dimension. So with that said, let's take a look at the latest rankings that we have.
Hi everyone, I'm Jen Cowney. I'm a strategy director at VML Y&R London. I am coming to you live from my office slash living room in London. So really trying to see whether or not we can make digital work today. I'm probably one of the least illustrious people you'll see today, which is very fun for me and hopefully in some way entertaining for you as well. And I have the honor of presenting a contribution from the UK to today's Follow the Sun presentation. As you can see, because the title's hopefully on your screen right now, my presentation is called Shooting the Breeze. Hopefully all of you know what that means, but if you don't, I thought I'd do that thing where you do a definition on a slide. It's an idiom from the USA, actually, not from the UK, but don't tell anyone. Shooting the breeze and then sitting around talking about unimportant things for a long time. Obviously, I'm not going to talk about unimportant things. I'm going to talk about very important things today, but for reasons that will become clear, it felt like the right title for this little presentation. When I was asked to kind of contribute to this, I was given all the best countries data, which is fascinating. You should definitely have a look at it. And asked to kind of look through, see what I could find that I could talk about the UK, something that sort of gave a bit of context, a bit of interest, a bit of insight into this strange little island we call home. And I found myself being less drawn to the things where we were doing very well. We are, for example, number two on having a well-developed legal framework, which obviously, because I work in ad agency, I know to be a good thing, but I couldn't really talk about in any great detail. And I found myself looking more towards the stuff where we were maybe doing not quite so well, because I felt like there was some richness there. I was actually quite taken with the fact that we rank very low for being sexy, number 64, considered doing a persuasive dossier and why that isn't the case, and then thought probably didn't want to lose my job. So I moved on and I found another statistic that really caught my eye, and it was this one. The UK ranked number 72 out of 78 countries for having a pleasant climate. I was shook. I was shooketh to my very core. I wasn't, of course. I think we all know why this is. But I did think, well, look, I've been asked to talk about Britain, about things that you could talk about sort of holistically about all of the UK. And I think anyone who's seen the news recently will know that we're not doing a great deal of consensus right now. Quite a few points of contention here. But if there is one thing that unites us as a nation, if there's one thing that no matter our age, our gender, our voting preference, which of the four countries we actually live in, there is one thing that we love. And it is that we absolutely love to talk about the weather. That is very much a truism about Britain. I don't think it's even necessarily a stereotype or a silly cliche. Actually, while preparing this presentation, I've become acutely aware of how often I start a Microsoft Teams meeting with an observation about the sky, and the answer is it's every single one I go on. In fact, to that end, I thought I'd share a few little tidbits and snippets which could be useful for your next pub quiz, whether that's online or otherwise, about just how much people in the UK talk about, think about, and obsess about the weather. And it's actually quite insane. These statistics come from various sources of who knows what level of accuracy, but I'm putting them in anyway. Apparently, the average British person will talk about the weather for 4.5 months of their life, which is actually just an insane amount of time to be talking about it. According to the BBC, 90% of people in Britain will have talked about the weather in the last 6 hours. And again, I was like, surely I haven't. I live alone. How could I? I have talked about the weather at least twice a day. And apparently this one, I almost feel like there's got to be something wrong with the methodology here, but I'm putting it in because it really did, well, to be honest, quite shock me. Apparently we think about the weather in Britain for an average of up to 8 hours a week. That is one full working day. So God knows what we're doing. And of course, when I say weather, when I talk about Britain and British weather, I really do mean one specific type for which we are, well, I think fairly famous, and it's this one, rain. This is actually a book that I've read. It's great, and all of the words on the right are words that I took from it. We have an extraordinary number of words for rain. We really love to talk about the weather. Obviously, these come from various different dialects. In Britain, we have Scots English. We've got lots and lots of different sort of local, quite often largely forgotten dialects. We're very much a patchwork language. We have borrowed words from people who moved to Britain. We have borrowed words from places that we've been to on holiday or for one of various purposes. And we now have an absolutely extraordinary corpus of words for rain. And you really look at this and think, God, we do devote a lot of our time and our emotional and sort of psychological energies to thinking about the sky. And you know what? Why is that? Why do we love to do it? Obviously, as you'll have noticed, I work in the strategy department of an ad agency. And the way that I like to explain my job to people who don't know what it is that I'm kind of a massive creep who tries to work out why people do things and therefore how I might make them do other things for my clients through the medium of short film, posters, et cetera, et cetera. And so I thought, you know what, this is what I want to talk about today. I want to talk about why it is that we love talking about the weather, thinking about the weather quite so much here in Britain. I mean, the obvious answer is this one, which is that we do get rather a lot of it. Apparently last year we had 170 days of water falling from the sky in one form or another. And on the right here, you actually have a lovely live almost weather forecast for where I am right now. This morning it was raining, a rare bit of sunshine this afternoon, a balmy 15 degrees, lovely for early summer. And as you can see, predicted 9 out of 10 days of rain ahead. So there probably is a fairly strong case to be made for the fact that that Britain, because we get so much rain, we really love to talk about it. And I thought, you know, that's an observation. Is that really true? Is that actually where we are? And I've sort of looked a bit further. I went into meteorological data, which was really fun, actually quite a change to the day job. And I looked to see how we really do. How do we stack up in the grand scheme of things? Best country says we've got one of the worst climates in the world. Do we actually have the most rain? Are we actually the rubbishest? And I'm sad to say, we don't really have anything particularly spectacular. We don't actually wear the rain crown. Some fun stats. There is a place on Earth which has apparently the greatest number of rainy days, and it is 350 days a year, which is a lot more than 170. And that place is in Hawaii. It's not all of Hawaii. It's a specific mountain. I guess, you know, mountains rain, but still a lot more than we have. The number one country in the world in terms of the amount of rainfall each year, that's not how often it falls, that is just the quantity, it's Colombia. They have the most precipitation. The UK comes in a fairly tragic 72 on that list as well. I don't quite know why those two managed to add up exactly. And actually one that I really enjoyed, particularly because holidays are banned forever, is the annual rainfall in London is about 27 inches, which seems like it's quite a lot. I mean, certainly if it all fell at once, we'd all be in trouble. But it's much less than you get in both Rome and Sydney in Australia. So actually, there is a bit of a question mark here about, do we really deserve to be this low down? Is our weather that bad? I thought, well, probably not. There probably is something more at play here. What is it that we are doing? And what is it that this sort of underpins the people of Britain's behaviour, and that I should be trying to find out. So I did a bit more reading, went on the internet, even read some books to find out what it is about the UK that makes us love to talk about weather. And the truth is, and this is going to be quite an embarrassing truth, and particularly given that I'm doing a 20-minute presentation about it, truth is that actually it seems as though our obsession with the weather is nothing to do with the actual weather. It's actually something completely different, but possibly something to bear in mind. And I'm going to spend a couple of minutes on this. So this is mainly drawn from a wonderful author called Kate Fox. She's sort of an anthropologist. She wrote a book about watching the English. Obviously, the English are not the whole of the UK. We're going to slightly extrapolate here, but let me get away with that one. And she has sort of some really fantastic observations about why people behave the way they do, how they talk to one another, what the kind of cultural codes are. And this is what she found out about the UK. It turns out that our weather speak, which is now a word, is a form of code evolved to help us overcome our inhibitions and actually talk to one another Yes, embarrassingly, it seems that the reason British people love to talk about the weather is because we're so repressed and awkward that we don't know what else to do. And we tend to use it as an icebreaker. We tend to use it as a way of kind of signaling friendship to one another and trying to open conversations, engage what people's moods are. It's really not got that much to do with what's actually happening out there in the world. In fact, I think in this book, which has a whole chapter on the weather, as you would expect, this observation was made that it's a little bit like when you see monkeys grooming one another to sort of make friends. We do that, but we talk about rain and the cold. And I think that probably means that obviously, one, if you are not British, just know, and you're talking to someone who is, and they're just chatting on at you about the weather, know that you're probably, they're fine. They're just a bit nervous. They're just doing their best. And if you are British, you can now feel really sort of embarrassed and self-aware every time you do it for the rest of your life, that you are, in fact, just sort of doing a kind of slightly awkward cultural code. What I did really love as well, and that I did want to talk about because I thought it was fascinating, is that it turns out that not only is this a very common behavior, of course, and one that exists for a very specific social purpose, it's also one that's got real rules tied to it. And they were rules that I'll show you now. I've summarized them. And at first I read and I was like, that's completely not true. That's not why I do it. And as I read on, I went, oh yeah, actually, no, it really is. Every single one of these is absolutely the case. So rules we have about the weather in the UK. The rules, one, you're supposed to respond in kind. If someone says to you, it's cold out, and you don't respond about the weather, you've basically committed a kind of social sin and people will feel really weird about you. So yeah, if you ever find yourself not responding to someone talking about the weather, you've gone a bit sociopathic, unfortunately. You're supposed to agree with them, regardless of what someone says, even if they go, gosh, it's very warm, and you're actually feeling cold, you go, oh, yes, it is. It is warm, isn't it? Because that is how we apparently signal sort of openness and agreement with others, and how we signal that we're all on the same page and we want to be cohesive and harmonious, which is lovely. There is also, to that point, an accepted weather hierarchy. So there are, and again, I thought about this because I don't really like it when it's that sunny. It freaks me out and then it burns me. But I know that I'm supposed to say it's really nice when it's very sunny. And we all have this, like British people share a kind of known sort of subliminal hierarchy of what kind of weather is good and what kind of weather is less good. And we all adhere to it, even if it doesn't actually reflect our personal preferences. It's a sort of a group think exercise as we do. We also, when it comes to complaining about the weather, only allow it in certain ways. So you are, of course, allowed to say that the weather is bad. You're allowed to be like, ugh, it's raining cats and dogs out there. But if someone says to you, oh, it's very, very cold, and you're maybe from Canada, and you say, guys, you don't know the meaning of the word cold, you have missed the point entirely. And you, again, have made a social error, because the point isn't that it's cold or not cold. The point is that we're talking about it and you're meant to agree. And the fifth and final rule, that Kate Box observes, that I thought was great, is that all bets are off when it snows. We're very good with rain, but snow doesn't happen that often. And we're very confused because it's both attractive to look at and deeply inconvenient because nothing works. So once snow happens, no one has a clue what they're supposed to do with it. But there we go. We've got a little bit of an insight into what on earth we're doing. And if you ever wondered why we talk about the weather so much, a little bit more there. And of course, I could probably go on about this almost indefinitely, not least because it is my birthright, apparently. But I did wonder if maybe I could make a few more sort of intelligent points that perhaps are dubbed a little bit more with our industry and what we're doing. And the thing that got me thinking was an email in a newsletter that I received last month in my very own inbox. And it's from a comedian who I don't think likes ad agencies very much, so I thought I'd make him look like a key opinion leader. Anyway, it's this. It's called John Robbins, and he's a comedian. And he wrote this in April. We were having some really weird weather, like a heat wave, but also snow. And he wrote, it's snowing outside as I write this, and yesterday I put suntan lotion on. I sometimes wonder if in future years, when the earth is ravaged by climate change, as oceans boil and the sun is blocked out, the last person alive will say, well, if there's one thing you can rely on to let you down, it's the bloody British weather, before rolling their eyes and bursting into flames. And I thought, you know what, he has got a point here. We've kind of answered already whether or not the British preoccupation with weather is in any way to do with it. But surely, as a people who spend so much time on some level thinking about what's going on outside, like, surely we've noticed that things are getting a bit weird. You know, does this preoccupation mean that we might be more finely attuned to the gradual heat death of the earth? A question I've been asking myself for last week. And I think one thing that is worth saying here, and I'm very conscious of, is that Britain and the UK generally, we we are quite a temperate climate, i.e. what meteorologists would call fine. We are not being as immediately and acutely affected as so many other places in the world are. You know, we are very fortunate. We've had some flooding. We've had some, like for us, really hot days where it hits like 35 degrees, which is pretty normal for many places. But we're not talking about a place where we're dealing with, you know, horrendous bushfires. We're not talking about drought and famine. We're not talking about sort of massive, massive floods and hurricanes. So I'm conscious that we as an island are, we have it quite easy at the moment, but it is hard to ignore that stuff is changing. Even here where we basically just get rained on all the time, and it's just a question of how much, how little, and whether it snows in April. Are we thinking about this more? What are we doing this? So I went back to the best countries data to see what I had to say, and found something a bit more encouraging than us having a terrible climate, which is this. We actually ranked number 17 out of 78 for caring about the environment, a thing that I was almost a bit surprised to see, because I don't necessarily, even having grown up here, think of the UK as being kind of eco-warriors as a rule. And like most people who work in advertising, I'm conscious that, you know, I live in a bit of a bubble within the M25. But actually, it seems that that the UK is doing pretty well. In fact, there was a report that came out, obviously, late last year, the Environmental Performance Index, which ranks every country in the world for its performance across 32 sustainability indicators. And we became number 4, which is like just off the podium. Again, quite a shock, but really encouraging to see. And I suppose even in the last few weeks, many people might have noticed, if you're in the UK, the government's been announcing new targets, new commitments, this kind of the green industrial revolution. There's increasingly this awareness that actually the future of the country, the future of the world, in every respect, not just sort of will we still have one, is tied to being able to make a sustainable form of capitalism, a sustainable economy, the only economy that we have. So I think there's something really encouraging there. And it's been a bit of a depressing couple of years, if we're being really honest, but there's more that to do. There's more going on. And I'm not going to bore you with statistics about exactly what people in the UK think. You've probably seen this everywhere. But again, encouragingly, you see more and more people thinking in terms of their own behaviours, about what they can do to be more sustainable, how they can do their little part to sort of make the world better. But there is still, I think, a long way to go. I looked at these statistics, and the majority of the people in the UK still don't think we're doing enough to reduce carbon emissions. We still feel very worried about the future state of the environment. And if you were to filter this data for younger people, the numbers just go up and up and up. And I think there is something really important here. And that's just kind of where I almost wanted to sort of lead to before I hand over to my next person, which is about the fact that there is more to do. And we really do have a part to play in it. I'm along with many people, but certainly lots of people from my office in BMI NR London went down to the climate change marches at the end of 2019, before all this kicked off and we could go out without masks on. And it was really heartening to see how many young people, how many kids were there, how many people were there, you know, really showing up and making their voices heard for a change they wanted to see in the world. But also how many ad agencies were there, like this balloon on the left. I was quite jealous of this balloon. They had an advertising agency balloon about the fact that they wanted to do climate change. And I do think, and I'm sure lots of people who work in this industry feel the same. I've been to lots of talks and lots of conferences where people talk about this, and we either diagnose the problem and we go, yeah, it's quite bad, isn't it, climate change? Oh, we should probably do something. And or conversely, we say slightly adorable but like also nonsensical things like we can save the world with advertising, which probably isn't true. But I think there is stuff that we can do, and I think what I like to feel more and more, and what I like to see more and more working both in my office and looking more broadly, is that actually our job as creative agencies, as media agencies, is to help our clients to do their business and do their business well. And more of our clients actually are looking to sell sustainably. They are looking to create sustainable products and services. And it's up to us to do a really good job of making people want to buy those things. And I think obviously when speaking much more broadly than just London, than just the UK, but across the world, we are seeing so much more creative work that's coming out in this sort of direction and is really beginning, I think, to make an impact. And really beginning to be changing what people are seeing when they're looking at posters, when they're looking at TV, which I'm very proud of. And to that point, before I close, I was going to share with you a couple of pieces of work that have come out of the London office for VMOYNR. The first one, I was going to try and do a video, but I don't think my internet connection is up to it, so I'm going to skip over. Boom, boom. Oh, am I? Yes. The first one, I think, speaks to kind of, and to me, I think there is a sort of two-pronged strategy almost to the kind of work that agencies can do to help with climate change. The first is about individual human behaviours. So by all means, Google this later if you've got a chance. Outpro has recently run a new execution of a campaign called Good For You, which is all about the fact that eating out, for, of course, it's partly a health decision for people to have a sort of a dairy alternative, but it's also heavily driven by the fact that eating more plant-based, having less reliance on animal products is actually pretty good for the environment too. And the fact that, yeah, of course, you can do electric, you can do recycling, but it really helps sometimes also to eat a different thing. And the second thing, which was launched just yesterday, and I would definitely urge you to look up, is Lombard Odier, a Swiss investment bank who has just launched their natural capital strategy, which is all about the fact that actually we need to think beyond just individual behaviours and think instead about how we invest in the world around us. How do we help and support those businesses which are actually committed to long-term sustainable investments? So I haven't got a video for that because it wouldn't work, but please do look it up. So just to close up before I hand over, is there a link between the UK's love of the weather and our attitude to climate change? Probably not, no. That is quite a spurious link and one that I did just find quite interesting. But the fact is that we really do care about it. And not just as an icebreaker for conversation, this is our slightly dodgy, unpleasant number 72 in the world climate. And we do want it to be better. And I think I'm really, really heartened, and I hope you all too, to see how the UK is beginning to respond, and hopefully, fingers crossed, the future is greener. So thanks so much for having me. I hope you enjoy the rest of your day. That was me. You've probably seen my face twice now. Didn't think about that when I was doing the slides, but I will hand over to whomever is next.
Well, thank you all very much indeed. To celebrate this very special launch, we've created a very special app. It's a virtual reality experience where you can literally visit every single country that's featured in the 2021 study. Well, you can get it on your desktop, your laptop, your tablet, your mobile phone. All you need to do is just download it from the URL that's on the screen here. Enjoy, explore, it's full of interest and insights, and we'll be refreshing the content frequently over the course of the next few months. So please do go back frequently. Earlier, I talked about the significance of countries being seen as brands. This is being increasingly realised right across the world, not just by business leaders, but by governments at the most senior of levels. I caught up with the Prime Minister of the Netherlands and asked him how important he believes country brands are.
Mr. Prime Minister, what contribution do you think that retailing makes to the economy and society in general?
So many. I mean, it is the biggest employer in the Netherlands. 900,000 people are somehow connected to the retail sector, so it is huge in its economic impact. That means that many people, in many cases young people, start their working life experiences in the retail sector. It is also a place where you can learn how to be more entrepreneurial and how to start your own business. It is a sector in our economy which is very much focused on innovation and disruptive innovation. It is very much connected to the modern economy, to the internet, to online shopping. So there are so many positives. And it's also a place where people come together. It's also a sort of community place. In some of the stores, people drink a cup of coffee, meet friends, and then buy some stuff. So it has many, many impacts on society.
Mr. Prime Minister, you had a fantastic career at Unilever. You obviously know brands very well. Do you think country brands are as important as product brands?
Oh, they're crucial. And what I found in this job is that the brand of Amsterdam, the brand of the Netherlands, the brand of Eindhoven, or the whole commercial area around cities like Zwolle and Amersfoort are crucial for our international standing. And the fact that you can bike to school as a child, that it's relatively safe here, that there are so many possibilities when you like sports or culture. And I really learned to brand that much more than we did already.
One last question, Mr. Prime Minister. What advice would you give retailers today who are under a lot of pressure, under a lot of stress? Everything's changing very fast.
Yeah, but still, at the same time, you are in a fascinating sector. So enjoy what you are doing. We live only once. This is the real thing. This is not the... So you have to make the best of it. And there are so many opportunities for good salespeople, for good businessmen and women, to make use of all those opportunities which are out there. And do realize that you play a very important part in societies. You are really part of society.
Mr. Prime Minister, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Okay, bye-bye.
Wow, I can't believe it. We've come to the end of our broadcast. We're almost out of time. I'd like to thank everybody who participated in today's broadcast. And just to remind you again, please do download the app and enjoy going virtually into every single one of our countries in this year's 2021 Best Countries Study. So from me, David Roth, thank you very much indeed. And Mike, thank you very much indeed as well.
My pleasure. Feel free to reach out if you have any questions. Thank you.
Well, have a great rest of the day. Thank you very much indeed for joining us. We really appreciate it.